received for this grand event. I'm a dentist and a newcomer to this Hampton Roads area. The Filipino American National Historical Society is pleased to bring to you and to have all of you at this Pinoy Symposium. As many of you know, Pinoy Symposium is a gathering to discuss a common interest. And these are all here, and the common interest is, what is a Pinoy? This is the first event of its kind on the East Coast. The idea is to hold it once a year with alternating sites at Washington, D.C. and Virginia Beach. I was going to recognize everyone in the planning committee, but everyone in the planning committee is outside planning. So, let me explain to you what the term Pinoy means. It refers to a person of Filipino ancestry who resides in the United States. Obviously, many of us here are perfect examples, correct? I, for one, am a prime example. I was born in Manila, Philippines, and raised in West Virginia. I guess that makes me a hillbilly Pinoy. Any of you guys met anyone like me before? I'm thrilled and excited to be part of this symposium because I've met many in my predicament that do not speak Filipino but are Filipino ancestry. I'm sure many of you approach and say, are you Filipino? You say yes. Then they start speaking to you in the language and you go, stop! I don't know! Okay, each of us have our respective reasons for being here. But the bottom line is to learn to meet one another and have a great time. So now I'd like to turn over the floor to my other co-MC, who has spent countless hours organizing and promoting this symposium. Many of you know who she is. Without her expertise, we would not be here today. Let's give a round of applause for Edwina Lapa, please.
The next will be the reason why we're having a format like this, introducing the organizations, because a lot of young people are not aware as to why your parents are involved in these organizations. You know they go to these meetings, you know they go to their election balls, but it gives us an idea for us to learn about our culture, and organizations are part of that. There are over 60,000 Filipino-American organizations in the U.S. The very first organization was documented in 1870 in New Orleans, Louisiana. The common reason for organizations to exist is to share a common bond, whether it be for a certain language, a fundraising project, or just to get together for a big party. It is a meeting place to meet other people. In Hampton Roads alone, there are 42 Filipino-American organizations who share common purposes and goals within each group. The existence of these organizations, some from the mid-70s, serve as a common bond among Filipinos. It is important for our young to understand how they are interrelated to the Hampton Roads community. Let me introduce to you Craig Estrada, who will acknowledge the achievements of these organizations, and we want to acknowledge their achievements because they are part of the community and it's important for you to know why. Let's give a hand for Craig Estrada.
Good morning. Such a good turnout. I'm glad everyone's here. My name is Craig Estrada. I'm a second generation Filipino. I was born here in Tidewater. I'm a practicing dentist for 3 years. I don't like the word practicing because I don't practice with my patients. Smile. The purpose of this portion of our program is to inform you of the organizations which form the foundation and the background of our community. Tidewater as a whole consists of many cities, Norfolk, Portsmouth, Chesapeake, Virginia Beach, Hampton, Newport News, and others. We have approximately 42 organizations here in the area. Many formed initially for social reasons, and as time went on, and as they grew, their purpose began to change to achieve specific objectives. The organizations formed each having their own purpose and reason to exist, whether it be social, spiritual, or sports activities. They wanted to promote and protect the interests of the Filipinos. They wanted to cultivate unity and cooperation amongst all Filipinos. And they wanted to establish better relations and understanding between Filipinos and non-Filipinos. And lastly, to help install civic spirit, cultural pride amongst the Filipino community. The Filipino National Historical Society would like to recognize these organizations. for their support in our project. Unfortunately, not all the organizations were able to be here to respond to our support and our project. I'd like to briefly introduce you to these organizations. First, the American and Filipino Club of Tidewater. This organization was formed in 1979 to offer fellowship for couples with mixed marriages. Filipinos married to Americans. The majority are Filipinos married to American women. Various charities include the National Cancer Society, Multiple Sclerosis, Child Abuse, and their representative is Betty Rumel. Come on, Betty. The next organization was formed in 1974 as a sub-chapter of the Philippine American Communities of Tidewater. Their major purpose is to honor Our Lady of Pinifrancia through the Fiesta of Pinifrancia, honoring the Virgin Mother. Their representative is Mrs. Tessa B. of Florida. Come on in. Next is the Committee Association of Tidewater, which was formed in 1977 for social and religious activities. Approximately about 400 members with various fundraising activities, including Operation Smile, other Philippine charities. They honor St. Lorenzo, and their representative today is Bob Trinidad, the president, correct? President. The Cebuano Speaking Association of Tidewater is formed in 1983. Its goal is to interface with the community and to enhance the heritage of the Cebuanos. It was instrumental in starting the Santo Niño Fiesta. Involved with local projects and charities such as Operation Smile and fundraising for the King's Daughters, their representative and their first president is Mark Villaflor. CUPOT, or the acronym Council of the United Filipino Organization of Tidewater, was formed in 1976. It consists of 10 member organizations, and their primary goal is to build, probably what you've seen last night, the Filipino Cultural Center. It's an organization to coordinate the activities of the different Filipino member organizations. Their representative, Mrs. Clarine Padilla. Spiritual reasons, it was formed in 1981, the Filipino Apostolate. It was formed with the Tidewater Council of Filipino Ministry and recognized by Bishop Sullivan of Richmond, Virginia. It was created as a diocesan arm. Approximately about 1,400 members, and their main goal is to build the St. Lorenzo Spiritual Center. Father Leon Manalo will be in charge of this center. Bishop Sullivan has contributed now about $500,000 for this project. Their representative is Mr. Armando Placidez. The Filipino Women's Club of Tidewater, the oldest and largest organization here in Tidewater, formed in 1964, consists originally of the wives of Filipino servicemen here in the Tidewater area. They are involved with various charities and scholarship programs. The Hospital of King's Daughters, St. Mary's Infant House, Operation Smile, the Siemens House, Adopting a Child in the Philippines through the Christian Children's Fund, the Joy Fund, the American Cancer Society, March of Dimes, and the Miss Philippines Virginia Pageant. I'd like to introduce you to my mother, their past Vice President Chair of Stride, the present Vice President Chair of Stride. Also spiritual is NAFE, formed in 1987 to commemorate the Fiesta of the Immaculate Conception. It approximately has 36 families currently, and St. Lorenzo Spiritual Center is one of their programs that they are too involved. Their representative, President Chris Arriola. This is a unique organization, the next one I'd like to introduce you to. They are unlike other organizations, known as the Philippine American Golf Association, Pipeline. Their desire, and this is a quote, to chase the little white ball. They encourage fellowship and sportsmanship through golf. They were formed in 1975. They have 17 tournaments and a championship tournament. They're represented today as Mr. Rudy Federico. United Yokon Association Tidewaters, formed in 1976 to unite the Yokons in the area. Began mostly consisting of military servicemen. They are involved today with helping, the youth group is involved in helping us today as ushers. Their representative today is Mrs. Vivian Pinoy. Many of these organizations, they had part in supporting us here financially. Their presence and their support here has been a big benefit to us today. I'd like to see more of the organizations contribute in the future. So please get the word out, and thank you for coming and participating.
Thank you, Greg Strada. The next one we're going to do is recognize the graduates from high school and colleges. The person to do that is Roy Starris. He's a business entrepreneur, family man, and president of Travel Outlet of Virginia. Roy.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's my pleasure to be here. Part of the Phil-Am National Historical Society of 1990. Roy Astar, second generation Filipino, or we should say Pinoy, to get used to that. And born and raised here in Virginia. And it's a great honor to introduce to you the graduating class of 1990. I would like to go back into history and recognize the first Filipino students of the United States. Number Fred, please correct me. I'm off on these dates. The first significant wave of Filipinos to the U.S. were students called pensionados. During William Howard Taft's administration as the Philippines' first civil governor between 1901 and 1903, educational plans called for promising young Filipinos to the U.S. This manifestation of the quote, white man's burden at this time, gained the support of many Americans as a necessary obligation. This educational program started back in August 1903, following the approval of the Pensionado Act. The first group of 100 pensionados, screened from 20,000 applicants, departed in October 1903. And in 1907, 183 students were enrolled in 47 schools and colleges. With Purdue University had 11 students, the University of Illinois with the largest group of 13. They had enrolled in a variety of professional programs, such as education, 44 students, civil engineering, 32, agriculture, 23, mechanical engineering, 19, and medicine, 17. Then for about 20 years, Filipino students were viewed as disciples of democracy. They would return home to the Philippines and promote the American way of life among their own people. But the students then made an excellent reputation as serious scholars. And today, this tradition, thank God, of doing well in school still exists with our Filipino graduating class of 1990. Please give them a hand as they call out their names. And I'd like to introduce the high school students of 1990.
Thank you. I'll go from civilian engineering to major in biology.
Hi, my name is Derek Lee. I'm a graduate from Pinoy High School. Yeah. I'm planning to attend Virginia Tech and major in economics.
My name is I received an interdisciplinary studies degree at the University of Virginia last Sunday. This summer I plan on teaching organic chemistry and then hopefully travel to Europe with my parents' money. I'd like to take this from now and thank my family for all your support. Thanks for the car, Mom.
He is the second oldest of five children.
Unfortunately, at the age of 7, his father passed away. He was the only boy in the family. So you can see what a difference it made. Before he had entered college, he was already teaching students like yourselves, actually teaching elementary school students at Guagua Elementary School. By the time he reached the age of 18, he was already teaching students in the sixth grade. In 1929, he enrolled at the University of the Philippines in Manila to study pre-law. Now, to pay for his tuition and also to support his mother and his four sisters, he had to find a job. Luckily, he was able to get a job as an assistant bookkeeper working for the Bureau of Public Works, but only after taking and passing the first grade civil service exam. Now, at that time, he was making a grand total of 47 and a half pesos a month. So you can imagine how he was, that's what they were living on to support his sisters, his mom, and also going to school. But attending the University of the Philippines was not enough. In those years, the Philippines had the opportunity to send one student to West Point. However, in order to do that, the student from the Philippines had to compete with over at least 300 applicants each year by possessing a number one score in a difficult written exam, passing a physical exam, and also passing a final exam given by the military academy at West Point. Now, in those days, the top four students had a chance to go. The number one, and then they had three alternates. Colonel Puntelon took the test four times. If there's any common thread in the life of Lieutenant Colonel Puntelon, it's the desire and the determination to succeed. So the first time he took it, he was number six. The second time he took it, second time he was number four, making him an alternate. But he failed a physical exam, and he was informed that he could never go unless because of his condition, which at that time he had a maxillary sinus condition. Determined to go, in his own words, he volunteered himself at the medical school as a patient in which his maxillary sinus condition was corrected. Now, the third time he took the test, he became number one. However, he and the alternates failed the final exam given by West Point. The fourth time, he was number one, and he finally passed all the tests, and West Point accepted him in May of 1932. However, he didn't have the money to go. He had to find a way to finance his trip to the States. At that time, he only had 60 pesos to his name. He had to come up with 600 pesos to buy his uniform and to cover his transportation costs. To make matters even worse, he had to report to West Point before July 3rd, which was his 22nd birthday. At that time, you had to have been enrolled at West Point before you reached the age of 22. Therefore, he was pressed for money and pressed for time, because it only took 21 days to travel to San Francisco by boat and 5 days by train to West Point. Luckily, he received 300 pesos from a priest in Mexico, Pampanga, and asked from numerous relatives for contributions, and he was able to raise the necessary money. However, on the way to the United States, he encountered a storm. Now, of course, he couldn't fly northwest at the time. He was taking a boat. So he radioed West Point saying he wouldn't be able to make it for his 22nd birthday. Well, West Point, knowing them, their reply was, T.S. Sorry, rules are rules, and there's nothing we can do about it.
So, in the words of Colonel Puslam, the next 2 days he was despondent and heartbroken. However, while still in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, the War Department radioed him saying that he could take his oath in San Francisco instead of in West Point. So by doing it this way, he could take the oath for his 22nd birthday and was able to enroll at West Point. So he enrolled at West Point on July 2nd, 1932. Now his stay at West Point, he characterized his treatment as being treated as a foreign guest. But despite that, he was able to graduate from West Point in June of 1936. He immediately became a third lieutenant in the Philippine Commonwealth Army. In November 1936, he became a second lieutenant and was ordered to take a course in ordnance field service at Raritan Arsenal in New Jersey. By May 1939, he returned to the Philippines and became the Plans and Training Officer, Inspector at Large for the Philippine Army. His job at that time was to inspect all Philippine military bases, and specifically inspecting the weapons. On his last inspection, he met and married the former Rosario Vargas Macromon on April 21st, 1940. And on April 21st, 1940, that's when they were wed. At that time, he was the first lieutenant. Continuing on with his military career, the Philippine Commonwealth government then sent him to attend MIT, in which he graduated with a Master's of Science in 1941. At MIT, he wrote a thesis entitled Most Common Defects in Small Arms and Mechanical and Metallurgical Remedies Thereof. I'm sure that a lot of you liberal arts majors are interested in hearing about that. But the essence is this thesis enabled him to develop an unbreakable objective for small arms weapons. Now, before his discovery, the problem with the U.S. infield rifle was that it failed to eject the bullet before a new round could be fired. So his invention of an unbreakable ejector solved this problem, and he received the United States patent for unbreakable ejectors for small weapons, arms weapons, in 1944. After MIT, he was attached to the U.S. Army Ordnance Company and participated in the Louisiana maneuvers. By September 1941, he reported to the Frankfurt Arsenal to study the manufacture of armor-piercing projectiles. Then World War II came. So after the Japanese attack of Pearl Harbor, he was transferred to the Raritan Arsenal in New Jersey to study the maintenance of weapons. By April 1942, he was ordered to the West Coast and was assigned at the headquarters at the Presidio in San Francisco, where he served as an inspector of ordnance on the West Coast. By 1942, he was promoted to captain in the AUS and was assigned to the 2nd Filipino Infantry Regiment. He was the executive officer of the 2nd Filipino Infantry Battalion. In May 1944, his unit was dispatched to New Guinea. There he was transferred to the 1st Filipino Infantry Regiment, where he was given command of the 2nd Battalion. One battalion had 1,000 men. In this case, there was 1,000 Filipino Americans. He was then transferred to the 1st Battalion, and his unit campaigned in the island of Samar in Leyte. His mission, or their mission, was to mop up the area of Japanese and protect the naval base at Guiyang. During World War II, he received various commendations: the Bronze Star, the Philippine Military Merit Medal, the Department of Army Commendation Medal, various campaign ribbons, and the occupation ribbon. By 1945, he was sent back to the United States to go to the Command and General Staff School for the purpose of becoming a member of the General Staff of the Philippine American Division for the invasion of Japan. After the war, he became chairman of the Committee of Filipino West Point Graduates and members of the Philippine Commonwealth Army, whose purpose was to reorganize the Philippine Military Academy with the understanding that he would be the superintendent of the academy. Now, this committee was detailed to observe West Point, Annapolis, Coast Guard Academy, BMI, and the Infantry School at Fort Benning, Georgia, to help in the formulation of the plan for the reestablishment of the Philippine Military Academy. Unfortunately, because of Philippine politics, he was denied the position. At that point, Colonel Pucalan decided to become a United States citizen. So in 1946, he took the rank of captain in the United States Regular Army and keeping the rank of Lieutenant Colonel of the AUS. By 1948-1950, he had resumed back to his teaching career. At that time, he was a professor of military science and tactics in Salt Lake City, Utah, at the senior high schools for the ROTC. From 50 to 52, he was stationed at Camp Roberts, where he was the assistant chief, staff, G3, and later regimental commander of the regiments in the training division of the 7th Armored Division. He was responsible for training men for the Korean War. In 1952 to 55, he was stationed in Heidelberg, Germany as maneuver officer for logistics. And in 55-59, he was assigned as a staff officer for the Special Weapons Project at Sandia Base in Albuquerque, New Mexico. 59-60, he was stationed in Iran as an assistant military advisor. And from 60-63, he was assigned at the U.S. Continental Army Command headquarters here in Fort Monroe, Virginia, as an assistant inspector general for logistics. In 1963, he retired as a lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Regular Army, but he wasn't finished yet. He then taught physics at Prince Anne High School in Virginia Beach from 63 to 65. You know, Prince Anne High School is just down the corner. From 65 to 67, he became an assistant professor for the University of Virginia, Eastern Shore Branch, and taught physics. From 66 to 77, he was an assistant professor at the University of Maryland, Eastern Shore, teaching physics, physical science, structural design, and engineering graphics. He retired in 1977 as an assistant professor emeritus from the University of Maryland, Eastern Shore. He is the author of the constitution of the following Filipino-American organization: the Philippine American Committee of Tidewater, otherwise known as PACT, the Pampanga Language Club, and the Council of United Filipino Organizations of Tidewater. He is an active member of the Philippine American Veterans of Tidewater. He is the father of 6 second-generation Pinoys and grandfather of 14 third-generation Pinoys. Colonel Pucalan has this advice to all Pinoys: respect of your elders, respect of the laws of the land, learn proper etiquette, do your best in anything, and strive for excellence. Last but not least, criticize yourself first before criticizing others. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, I'm very proud to introduce, on behalf of the Philippine American National Historical Society, Hampton Roads Chapter, as our initial MVP, otherwise known as the most valuable Pinoy, and an educator, a military man, veteran, family man, civic leader, no other than Lieutenant Colonel Leon Pucalan.
Before each and every one of you leave here today, I hope you leave here knowing the answer to who and what is Pinoy. Before I begin, some of the comments I have may disturb you, and it should. It is my intention to stimulate each and every one of you to think about answering the question, who and what are you? I base all of my comments from personal experiences from being raised in a black ghetto in Seattle, Washington, for the first 18 years of my life, not associated with Filipinos. Undergoing a transformation into becoming a Pinoy, from working 10 summers in a salmon cannery in Kenai, Alaska, with a crew of 40 Pinoy migrant workers in order to pay for my college education. And the past 7 years in private practice as a successful dentist in Virginia Beach, Virginia. In essence, I have experienced the extremes of the entire labor spectrum. Throughout the years, I am still being mistaken for a Japanese, a Chinese, or a Hawaiian. I am still being asked by Filipinos, when are you going back home? And why in the Philippines, even though I have never been to that country? Or, why don't you learn the language, since I do not speak any Filipino dialect? In filling out forms under the category of race, to this day, I still check other. Even though I was told to classify myself as an Oriental, later as a Pacific Islander, and today as an Asian. Throughout my life, I have been called a flip. A nigger. A nigger Pino. The square trying to fit into a circle. The renegade trying to figure out his purpose in society. Brothers and sisters, I am a second generation Pinoy. What does this mean? By definition, a first generation Pinoy is a person of Filipino ancestry who was born and raised in the Philippines and came to the United States to live. Their children are second generation Pinoy because they were born and raised in the United States. If a person was born in the Philippines and came to the United States at the age of 13 or younger, I consider this person more second generation than first because he is being raised in the United States during junior high school years. Does everyone understand the difference between a first and second generation Pinoy? Okay. How many of you are first generation? Show you. Raise your hand. You gotta be proud. You're first generation. Okay. How many of you are second generation? Yeah. How many of you are third? Now that we understand the difference between a first and second generation Pinoy, what is a Pinoy? First of all, I am an American. I plan to live and die in this country. However, this term is superfluous because America is a race-conscious country. This country is made up of many distinct and unique ethnic groups. This is what makes this country great. Contrary to what some people think, America is not a melting pot of cultures. America is a symphonic orchestra with each ethnic group representing the distinct sounds of different and unique instruments which comprise the symphony. Because we are a people of color, an identity crisis exists when trying to answer, what am I? Because we live in America. Some of us have asked, what are you? Would answer, I am Filipino. Others would answer, I am Filipino, with a P. Because there is no F in the Philippine alphabet. Some would say they are Filipino American with a hyphen, which implies Filipino American as one word. Others would say they are Filipino American with no hyphen, implying American as a noun and Filipino as the adjective. Others would say they are American Filipino, as in what kind of Filipino? American. they are just American. But this term is ambiguous and too vague. Since America is a race-conscious country, your brown skin, black hair, dark eyes, and flat nose does not put you in a typical blonde hair, blue-eyed, all-American image. Filipino, Filipino, Filipino-American with a hyphen, Filipino-American, no hyphen, American-Filipino, and American. That's six terms to identify with in answering the question, what am I? Does an identity crisis exist? I think so. Now let's use each of them, every one of them, in practical use. We'll start off with Filipino. Say I'm walking down the street, and a recent Filipino immigrant would come up to me and go, oh, excuse me, what are you? Probably I'd say that and said, I'm Filipino. And the recent immigrant would come back and say, oh, I'm a Pumamo. Or something, you know, their dialect, you know what I'm saying? And more often than that, I had to apologize and say, I'm sorry. I don't speak your language. And what would the recent immigrant would say? Oh, what kind of Filipino are you if you don't speak Tagalog? Well, you know what I'm talking about. Did you feel hurt? Did you feel angry? Who was the villain here? Since I was born and raised in America, never been in the Philippines, and don't speak Filipino, the term Filipino does not work for me. What about the term Filipino? Well, Filipino doesn't work. I don't think Filipino is going to work either. So let's move on. Huh? And now my favorite, American Filipino. Same situation. Recent immigrant comes up to me and says, excuse me, what are you? I tell him, I'm an American Filipino. Aha. Filipino is the noun. American is the adjective. And what happens? He starts talking to me back in English. What's your name? Right? However, well, it's going to work for me. However, how many of you know who Prince is? You know the rock star? Yeah. How many of you know who Diamond Phillip is? You know the actor, La Bamba? Right? Prince's great-grandfather happens to be Filipino. Lou Diamond Phillip's mother is Filipino. Both stars have Filipino ancestry. Now, imagine a prince, and here comes the recent immigrant. excuse me, what are you? The prince goes, hey, I'm American Filipino. Do you think that term is going to work for you? I don't think so. This term, unfortunately, does not work for them and for most people who are mestizos, because most first generation Pinoys refuse to accept their Filipino-ness. Instead of acceptance, comments like, they do not look Filipino, or they are not pure Filipino, or they are too black to be Filipino, or they are too white to be Filipino. I stand before you to tell you, mestizos are a part of the Pinoy community, just as the recent Filipino immigrants. Mestizos are not trying to be Pinoy, they are Pinoy because of their Filipino ancestry. By denying a mestizo his or her Filipino-ness, you are denying the existence of their Filipino ancestors. Since we live in America, chances of your children or grandchildren being mestizo increases. By discriminating against mestizos today, you are jeopardizing your existence in the future. Think about it. And finally, the term Filipino American. Well, I think that term is really, really vague. I mean, you might as well just call yourself a nation, you know? But bear with me. What's a Filipino? Okay, it's not just somebody from the Philippines. You've got Elecanos, Tagalogs, the signs, Capitanio, Moros. Yeah? What's an American? An American's not just white. You've got blacks, Irish, Italian, Chinese, Japanese. Right? Put the two together. What do you got? Aloha. Again, I ask, what am I? According to history, between 1920 to 1930, approximately 45,000 Filipinos immigrated to this country. For some reason, they called themselves Pinoys. They were the first ones to make the distinction that a Filipino is a person of Filipino ancestry who resides in the Philippines. A Pinoy is a person of Filipino ancestry that lives in the United States. They did not say that Pinoys are better or Filipinos are worse. They are saying we are made from the same stock, Filipino, but we live in different environments. Therefore, we are different. We are hybrids. Filipino implies Philippines. Pinoy implies the United States. The term Pinoy is all of the six terms mentioned before, but take it one step further in trying to answer the question, what am I? Pinoys are more concerned with issues that are happening here in America, not in the Philippines, because we live here. Issues like drugs, teenage pregnancies, gang violence, racism, discrimination, high school and college dropouts concern me as a Pinoy more than the latest coup attempt in the Philippines, because I live here, not the Philippines. The six terms mentioned before are more or less concerned with physical characteristics, the color of the skin, hair, eyes, etc. As Pinoys, we are more concerned as to what is happening here, the heart, and here, the brain. As a Pinoy, the emphasis is shifted from I or me to we or us. In other words, as a Pinoy, I am not only concerned with my personal achievements and successes, but I am also concerned about the success and failure of our people as a whole. Because we live in a race-conscious country, my personal actions, both the good and bad, affect the Pinoy community as a whole. For example, when a patient walks into my office, he sees me as a Filipino first and a dentist second. Whatever I do is not only a reflection of my family, but is also a reflection of my people. With this in mind, I make 110% efforts or go the extra mile in any endeavor I am involved in. This process of doing more than what's required is the first step in becoming a Pinoy. There is a misconception amongst first-generation Pinoys that once their child gets an education and becomes employed, that's it. He is now assimilated into American mainstream, and involvement with the Filipino community would be a step backwards. I stand here before you to tell you this is wrong. Because we are a people of color, we will never assimilate. Because of our brown, because of our skin, we stick out. It is against human nature that people of color can assimilate. I think this is good, because assimilation leads to conformity, and conformity leads to mediocrity. What is wrong with accepting our uniqueness and making an effort to enhance it while living in harmony with the other ethnic groups? As Pinoys, our goal is not to be better than anyone else. Our goal is to be treated as good as everyone else. We demand a fair deal, and we should not accept any raw deals. As Pinoys, we have an unwritten commitment to make life a little easier for the next generation. In order to do this, we need everyone to get back into the community and share their expertise so they may lead the next generation down the path in which they have been. To you college graduates, I stand before you to tell you your degree or fancy title means nothing until you give something back to the community. What can you do? Make yourself available by becoming a role model. Share your experiences with underclassmen and recent high school graduates. Tell them what classes to take, or better yet, which professors to avoid. To you underclassmen, set up study groups or a tutorial program. For God's sake, save your old tests and notes so you can start a file which the next generation can use to help them study. Make yourself available to the recent high school graduates who are following in your footsteps. Help them make the transition from high school to college by sharing your experiences. To you recent high school graduates, do not be afraid to ask questions to these college students. They are here today for you. They remembered what it was like when they graduated from high school and being away from home for the first time. To all of you students and graduates, start becoming a Pinoy instead of a Filipino living in America. In summary, a Pinoy is a person of Filipino ancestry that lives in the United States. A Pinoy is a person concerned with issues that take place here in the United States and not in the Philippines. A Pinoy is a person not concerned with physical traits, but is more concerned with what is happening here and here. A Pinoy is a person concerned with we or us instead of I and me. A Pinoy is a person concerned with making life easier for the next generation. In order to become better Americans, we have to become better Pinoys. In order to become better Pinoys, we must answer the question, who are we? In order to answer the question, who are we must know our history. What is the definition of history? According to Webster, history is an account of what has happened, especially in the life of a people or country. History is the foundation of which the life of a people stands on. Knowledge of one's history reinforces one's identity, instills pride in existence, establishes dignity in oneself, and focuses one's direction. In order for you to know where you are going, you have to know first where you have come from. If the definition of history, which is an account of what has happened, especially in the life of a people or country, is correct, therefore one can conclude that if a people or a country has no history, it does not exist. Today, Filipinos are the largest Asian ethnic group in the United States. We outnumber the Japanese, the Chinese, the Vietnamese, the Koreans. We are the largest. Period. Filipinos are the oldest Asian ethnic group in the United States today. We came here before the Japanese, the Chinese, the Vietnamese, the Koreans. We have been in this country since 1763. We are the oldest, period. If Filipinos are the largest and the oldest Asian ethnic group in the United States, why are we not mentioned in American history texts? I feel this is a blatant injustice. As the great black American leader Martin Luther King Jr. once said, and I quote, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." End quote. When I sat in American history class, I had to learn about the migration of the Germans, Italians, and Irish into this country. I had to learn about the plight of the blacks from the days of slavery from Martin Luther King. I had to learn about the Japanese internment camps during World War II. I had to learn about the Korean War and the Vietnam War. But what about us? I wanted to know about Filipinos living in America. After all, we are the largest and the oldest Asian ethnic group in the United States. By not being mentioned in American history books or American history class implies two things. Number one, we are not worthy enough to be mentioned. And number two, we do not exist. Let me digress for a moment. The accomplishments and significance of great Filipino leaders such as Jose Rizal, Manuel Quezon, Ramon Magsaysay, and Ferdinand Mike Marcos are nice and double, but they are part of Philippine history. Because I live in the United States, I want to know more about Pinoy history. That is, the history of people of Filipino ancestry that live in the United States. I want to know why the first Filipino settlement was in New Orleans, Louisiana, in 1763. I want to know why, in 1930, a Mr. D.W. Horvath, who was a Northern Monterey County Justice of the Peace, denounced Filipinos as, and I quote, the most worthless, unscrupulous, shiftless, diseased, semi-barbarians that ever came to our shores, end quote. He charged the Pinoys with being disease carriers, destroying the American wage scale, and attempting to allure young American and Mexican girls. This judge asserted that, and I quote, Filipinos migrating from a very primitive society were able to live 15 in one room and sustain themselves on rice and fish. In short, they corroded American standards of labor and morality. End quote. I want to know why Pinoys could not become American citizens until July 2nd, 1946. I want to know why Pinoys could not own land before 1946. I want to know why Pinoys could not intermarry with whites in the state of Virginia until 1967. I want to know why Filipinos who fought for this country under the American flag during World War II to this day are being denied American citizenship. Brothers and sisters, these are the real issues I am concerned about. The answers to these sensitive questions can be found in Pinoy history books and articles. Today, you have access to bibliographies of over 200 books and articles on Pinoy history. We are somebody. We are something. We do exist. We do have a history. We do have a heritage. This purpose of this symposium is not only to educate ourselves as Pinoys about ourselves, but to stimulate thought in the quest of answering the question, who are we? The Pinoy heritage and culture is what I plan to preserve and pass down to the next generation. Pinoy history is the foundation I stand on. If the American educational system does not take the time or effort to teach our young students Pinoy history, who will? The answer to this question came in 1982 with the formation of the Filipino-American National Historical Society. The mission of this organization shall be to promote understanding, education, enlightenment, appreciation, and enrichment through the identification, gathering, preservation, and dissemination of the history and culture of Filipino Americans in the United States. Today, the founding president of the Filipino American National Historical Society is here with us. In this library, there are three books written about Filipinos in the United States. On the cover of one of the books is a picture of the Filipino Youth Activities Drill Team of Seattle, Washington, which he founded in 1957. He is the author of the first Filipino-American history book ever written in 1983, entitled Filipinos, Forgotten Asian Americans. He is truly a trailblazer, a great human being, a great American, a great Pinoy, the godfather of Pinoyism. I present to you my uncle and your uncle too.
Just blew my whole darn presentation. I don't know how to start. I mean, after listening to the good colonel, as you can see, it's 8:15 Seattle time. And I'm still, my head is still up in my thoughts, but I would like to say to you, in the language of Jose Rizal, in the language of Lapu Lapu, but in a true Filipino language, the dialect of Gabriela Sinam, Good morning. If everyone is on a high, it is because he received a personal phone call yesterday, and he was not around to receive it because he was so busy. Working on the symposium. She is not on the list of who's who among Pinoys in the United States. I'm talking about a PR race and planning committee. This is for true because I heard the voice myself. She was a playgirl of November 88. She is the video playgirl now of June 1990. Man, let me tell you, that video is wild. But she took enough time to express her disappointment that she could not be here to join you today. And that was Peter Reyes. Pay tribute if I can, and since I'm on camera, to a young lady in Washington, D.C., who also called Helen. She has leukemia. She's lying in bed right now in Washington, D.C., and I know that her spirit is here with us. Her name is Cherokee De La Rosa. I'd like to have all of us, just for a minute, give her a hand, would you? This is the beginning of being Pinoy. As Alan said, it's we, us. But it's actually Philippine. In that, in the Tagalog, it is tayo-tayo. As opposed to sila-sila. Tayo-tayo, we, as opposed to them. We gotta go back into that area of what is innate in us as being Filipino. Because after all, if I am proud to be a Pinoy, it is because of the things that I have that is innate in me, that even many, many times other Asians do not have. And one of them is the generosity, the hospitality, how we are able to give of ourselves. And when you look again through all the many different social revolutions in this country, particularly the Asian Pacific American movement, it's been the Pinoy that has given much, much to the detriment of our own community because they have got co-opted. And when they were students, they were not able to keep up with their scholastic or their academic work. But in their generosity, and so therefore it is innate in us. You see, although we're talking about Filipino America, we have to also remember that which is Philippine. You cannot have rice without a loaf. You can't have pagoa unless you've got tomato and onion to go with it. You can't talk Philippine, or especially, you can't talk that which is American in us unless you know from whence we came from, which is Philippine. It's an undeniable fact. For those of you, and I see that there are very, very few of you who are going to take education, if when you have to teach this, and you can as an MD, you can as an accountant, you can as an engineer, because we're talking about our life experiences is what we're talking about. You have to, first of all, understand that which is Philippine history in relationship to United States history. You have to understand the psyche of that which is Filipino in order to then be able to explain that which is Filipino-American. But you have to also see that in New Orleans, we are now Pinoys to the ninth and the tenth generation. If Edwina in this room is the only third generation here, think in terms of New Orleans. When I walked down the jetway in New Orleans for the first time in 1988 to celebrate the 225th anniversary, started by our historical society, I looked at every black brother and sister and I said, my God, any one of them could be Pinoy. That is a fact. In California, they are down to the sixth generation, at least, including Hawaii. For every Chicano that you see, think in terms that he or she might also be Pinoy. In Washington State, they are down to the fifth generation, but Pinoys were with the Nootka Indians in Queen Charlotte Island, up in British Columbia in 1850, being kind to every Native American. They could just be your grandfather and your grandmother. So what is a Pinoy? It's all these many, many things that Alan was talking about. You saw, first of all, the genius of the Pinoy in a good kernel. Now I'm looking at the genius of the Pinoy in all of you. Because we are that. We have to say to ourselves, first of all, just like the Black Panthers did, that black is beautiful, I say too that brown is beautiful. Here in the Eastern Seaboard, I'm always in wonderment. Because in this very, very room is the intelligentsia of the seaboard, of our Pinoy seaboard. If anything happens to any one of you, it's going to be a great loss to our community, to our people. You are still, though, a rare, rare bird. Because in the campuses of UCLA, of Southern Cal, Washington, Idaho, Montana, Kansas, Illinois, there is no such gathering that can happen such as this. And this is why Alan and Edwina had the vision to call all of you together. Pinoy, like anything else, somebody has to call the party. You can go to parties, but somebody's got to call them. Somebody's got to organize them. And that is your first task, once you've saved yourself. Now I'm going to keep on saying, once you've saved yourself. You are not good to us as high school dropouts. You are no good to us as college dropouts. You are no good to us just as dreamers, but not as doers. But neither are you good to us if you're just doers and have no dreams. It's all these things all put together. Who is a Pinoy? A Pinoy, or Filipino-American as the title of the book, is a minority. What is a minority? I think there's only one other minority like me in this room today. Well, the kind, come and get. The gentleman that's wearing Nike shoes, please stand up. Therefore, I am the only minority. I purposely went and dressed down. The wife said to me, you mean you're not going to dress up? You're going to go to Virginia Beach. I said, hey, ma'am, I'm going to be talking to students. And if I put on a suit and a tie, which I do every day, I'm not going to feel comfortable. There's a right way, the wrong way, the Army way, the Navy way, and it's also the Pinoy way.
It isn't only how we look in our banquets, in our beautiful suits and our tenderness. It is, again, is what is here and what is here and what we can do with this. And the question is, what are we going to do? I'm going to show you, first of all, then, what other Pinoys have done before you. 5 years ago, as part of the 225th anniversary, everything that you see in these slides are all Filipino-American or Pinoy. We talk about organizations. The community of ours is not just made up of organizations as leaders seem to think. Our community is made up of individuals such as you. However, the phenomena of organization is in us. In 1870, therefore, in New Orleans, they already began to organize. 1870, this is a benefit society, and it is believed to be the first Filipino-American organization. Look at these faces. New Orleans people at the turn of the 19th century. They're mixed. Therefore, thank God for the white mothers. Thank God for the Indian mothers. Thank God for the black mothers, the Mexican mothers, because without them, we wouldn't have had a community with the shortage of just Filipinos. Look throughout. Look at these faces. Study the faces carefully as well and ask yourself, particularly those of you that are going to go into health sciences, exactly what does a Pinoy look like? Martin Borobud, one of the pioneers in New Orleans. Two other women were part of the Borobud family. This was taken along just about 1896-1890. Pinoys. Now again, look at the face. New Orleans. Typical again, our community organizations, get-togethers, very, very strong. This is in New Orleans. Look at the very background. You'll still see already the Philippine flag and the American flag. It is also innate among Filipinos to understand the patriotism and the loyalty that Filipinos have had, not only to the United States, but to the Philippines as well. Shrimp, drying shrimp in Manila Village. They're on a platform in New Orleans, because this is one of the seven original villages that were formed in New Orleans. All of the planks are gone, all of the houses are gone. In 1965, this Manila Village in New Orleans was destroyed by a storm, by Hurricane Betsy. Can you read this? 1906, a group of Filipino students in a convention in Chicago. 1906. You guys get together here in 1990, you are keeping on now a tradition. You are not the first. If you think you are the first, it is because the innateness in you, there was a call of you to join your brothers and sisters. Very, very annoying. This is in Berkeley, along about the same time, University of California, about 1910 or so. Navy did not begin of the recruitment of Filipinos after World War II. These are two gentlemen who got out of the United States Navy before World War I. Clemente Martina Jenkins, the first Pinoy to settle in Seattle in 1909. She came from Naga in the Bicol province in the Philippines, married a sergeant by the name of Frank Jenkins. He was black and Mexican. Therefore, this family, which is now down to the fifth generation in Seattle, the first Filipino family, was not only Pinoy, but it was also black, and it was Chicano. Hawaii. Sugarcane. hard, hard jobs. Sugarcane, pineapple, so on. By this particular point, the United States, in the form, the persons of the sugarcane plantation owners, wanted cheap labor. Puerto Rico was too far, they didn't want any blacks, they had too many Japanese and Chinese and Koreans already. Let's go to our colony, they are ours, called Filipinos. Typical camp. Now, if after 3 years contract, they would go back to the Philippines, or they would go on to the mainland. The majority of these people were Cebuano, Visayan, from Aklan, from Iloilo, as well as Ilocano. And the whole idea of that was they wanted to stay away from Manila because they thought that only in Manila were people who could read. They wanted illiterate people because if you can't read, you can't start anything. And they wanted to keep people down. They had expected the children not to go to school but to follow their parents into the fields. Did I hear of the Balikbayan and all these other things, the travel agencies? Ship lines did the same thing. In the meantime, the lure to the United States kept coming. Here's a poster of the dollar of the president lines. And then they come. In the middle is a visitor. He's from Cebu. He's become eventually the president of the Philippines, Sirio Osmeña. To the left of him is another one who I think is Rojas, Manuel Rojas. He's also another Philippine president. They say that there were no women. One of the things that you're going to see in these pictures is the constant show of women. Asian American studies erroneously and falsely teach that the only Filipinos that came over were men. Illiterate, bachelors who ended up in Chinatowns and in the ghettos of our country and did not have any Filipino women. Wrong. Take a look at this. If Edwina is third generation, where did her grandparents come from? Particularly the grandmother. The first professionals in the United States were women. As Filipinos, recognize that we come from an egalitarian society. That women do not walk behind us, they walk side by side with us. That women are not inferior to us. That they are equal. Who runs your households? Who keeps the money? Who makes the big decisions? Who deals with the establishment? All right? This woman was the first nurse in New York in the 1920s. Her son is a second generation. But afterwards, they moved back to the Philippines, and the son does not come back to the United States until after he's 60 years old and is now living in Chicago. You will see how proud these people are. Handsome men. And anytime there's a picture to be taken, you know darn well. Begins to sprout. This is the beginning of our second generation. You can see there, though, that all of the women are not necessarily so-called benign, but that there are women of other color, particularly the white women. In that one state where they fell in love with Filipinos, they have to make hard, hard decisions. Those of you whose mothers are white, kiss her. Those of you whose grandmothers are white, to understand what they had to go through to become Filipinized, because many of them became ostracized by their own families. And yet they persevered. They are the ones that gave our men the respectability and the reason for being respectable, for having family, love, comforts of home, which is also innate all of us as human beings, how much more so in our, you know, in our Philippine society. A mother and the two in the back are now great-grandparents, second generation in California. I don't know, I'm gonna flip it to the next slide. The right-hand side. Today, her great-granddaughter got her medical degree in San Francisco. And I wish I was with her. This is my sister. However, your company is more important. Los Angeles, why was this picture taken? Mama, daughter. Stockton, California. Hard work. Cutting asparagus is stooped labor. But when you do it where the shade is 110 degrees and it's dusty, and you do it for 12 hours to 14 hours a day, from sunrise to sunset, then it begins to take on a different character. These generations, these Pinoys, are the ones that said to my generation, the second generation, "Yo, second generation, you got to go to school. You cannot do this like us. You got to go to school, you second generation." Forget my accent as much as to think in terms of the wisdom of what they were trying to say to us. And that is still being articulated today by your own particular parents. Oops. Oops. Oh, excuse me, I'm butt driver. See, even out in the field, now these are rare, because Filipinos during those days really didn't like to have their picture taken with their work clothes on. They wanted to be postura. I got to wear my suit. I have to wear my Americana. You know my jacket. You know my corbata, my tie. And then I can send that back to the Philippines and say, "Hey, look, my good, I'm a big guy, see? I'm doing well." But they don't understand, those of you who came from the Philippines, how hard it was for your uncles, your grandfathers, to send money back so that you could go to school. This is how they were doing it. If they were doing it this way, they were bellboys, washing dishes, in the kitchens, in the canneries. But pride and respectability, hard work, all those virtues that Colonel Fusilon was trying to say, this generation had. A cockfight. You can't see the cockfight. One of the national pastimes of Filipinos is not basketball. It is double cockfights. Or seven card rummy, or pinochle. I'm glad I'm a Pinoy. Not only because there's so many beautiful women out there, and I have to say that. Yes, really. It just blew my mind to see some of you last night and today. You are just beautiful, all of you are. But I'm also glad I'm Pinoy because of the food. To eat lunch, Pinoy style, for me, is not a sandwich. I have to have my rice and my fish and whatever it is, and even out in the fields, it was still a good meal, because a good meal is with rice. Oops, here we go again. They're all common workers, menial labor, but they held their heads up high in pride. They hurt inside. They were pained inside. They were humiliated many times, but they held their head up.
I think this is self-explanatory in 1930. And one of those people got killed, Herman Tabera, was shot in a bunkhouse when a bunkhouse of 50 men were invaded one night by the so-called vigilantes, because by now the Filipino threat in Salinas Valley was getting up there, and he was shot through the heart. Our clubhouses were also bombed. This is in Stockton, California in 1930, after the explosion. Anti-riots, anti-Filipino feelings. This is a classic in that it says positively no Filipinos allowed in all of the hotels. And I can remember this because my hometown was in California. Now this is overt racism. Nowadays, in many parts of our country, it does no longer say signs, but it's still in the head. You still can't many times live where you like to live. Despite all of your credentials and your degrees, you could be or cannot be employed, and that's why we have such things as affirmative action. And even then, that civil rights law is being threatened constantly in Congress. Students. This is the University of Washington, about the turn of the 1930s. It was because of students in those days, they're the ones that gave us the pillars of what our Filipino community is today, particularly on the West Coast, as well as in Chicago. You ever notice how well they dress? And that's how you guys look today, well dressed. Alaska. Think in terms of Alan Bregano having to work there all during the time he was going to college. He was a butcher. And a butcher is a guy who slides the fish in an open knife. And if you slide it too far, your hand can get cut off. Can you imagine a one-armed dentist? Philippine flag, American flag, always get-togethers. This is a Filipino press club. Down at the bottom, they're holding a pennant. Very, very nationalistic, very, very Filipino. Because the time of independence of the Philippines was a very, very strong concern of Filipinos here in the United States. Not only the Navy, Army. We had numbers of Filipinos, as Colonel Consolan can attest to, who served in the United States Army during World War I. Navy. The San Francisco Club for Women, this is along about the 1930s. For those of you who do not know what these beautiful piña dresses are, they are almost now a collector's item. But that's the way they dressed when they got together. They really gussied it up. My kids saw this. I have 8 kids. The oldest one is 37. He said, gee whiz, Dad. Do you mean tell me they were still smoking pot during those times at the joint picnic? That's the difference between a second and a third generation. This is Montana. They worked in railroads. Orderlies in hospitals. Boxers
but this guy was really just keeping and training in the canneries. We had world-class boxers, from a Pancho Villa in the 20s to a Seferino Garcia that was flyweight and then middleweight, to Bernard Bakusin, who was a contender for the welterweight championship. We had some world-class athletes, and those athletes were the ones that gave the Pinoys at that particular time pride. He also worked in the logging areas. Now, why he's at a cold storage thing, I don't know, but we stuck it in because the guy is posing as usual, Navy guy. The Chinese built the Northern Pacific. The Pinoys worked basically in the Great Northern and the rock between Milwaukee through Spokane through Seattle. Every time they could, they would get together. These Pinoys became the surrogate aunts, surrogate sisters, surrogate mothers. They became, in their own way, the princesses of the Filipino community. See, banquets and get-together, dinners, formal dinners, are nothing new in our community. You guys had to live through it as you guys were growing up. Imagine what I had to go through. Now, probably, all of them own that car. But the guy who drove it, there's only one guy that could drive. Company car. And the family's getting bigger and more. This family intrigues me in that there's Chinese in us. In the Pangasinan area, there's a duck industry that was attributed to the Japanese. There's Spanish in us. But this sort of intrigued me because there was a lot of East Indian in the basis of these people too. There's a word in Tagalog, Sipoy. If you can remember that in 1850, the British invaded Manila and for 2 years occupied Manila. There weren't enough British soldiers to go there, and so they sent the Sipoys, who were Bombay. And actually, when you refer to those things, it comes out of Bombay, the people from Bombay, and the descendants thereof. Here we go now with the other kinds of Pinoys, so exemplified by the mother. Mexican. Still, posing. They may be dishwashers, they may be menial laborers, but you couldn't tell. No. We just refer to him as the pastura guy. The guy, the handsome guy. Look at that. Gloves. Hat tilted the right way. What is the Pinoy as opposed to any of the other Asians? You can tell basically by the way they dress. The way they pose. Exactly. Oh, too bad. And you can see the suit. Again, I wonder whether Nicholas really owned this car. But it went to the Philippines. See? And they must have said, oh my goodness, look at Nicholas, good car. So what's the next question? What's the next sentence? I've got to go to America too. There's another one. That's not his car, I know it's not his car. And if you know Seattle well, that's Chinatown. Not bad, that would be nice. And Pinoys? These are still in the 30s, now slipping off into the 40s.
again you'll see the interracial mixing. That's the Pinoy community. Stockton Filipino Community Club. We also have parades in California, it was big enough. Now this is the lodges. Pool rooms. You want to know about anything in the Filipino community in the old days, you go to the pool room or the barber shop. You learn everything. Who is putting this? Anybody, everything you wanted to know about news, you went to the barber shop or the pool room. But the pool room was basically the only type of business that Pinoys were also allowed to go to. And they could not go into the athletic clubs, they could not go into public swimming pools, they had to go to shows in many, many cases, they had to sit in the back just like the blacks, or in the balcony or whatever, segregated areas. And so this is what happened also in our community. They had athletic events. This one is in basketball, and I think the next one is volleyball. One of the who's who in your list that you look through, one of the last names is Gary Sato, S-A-T-O. That's not necessarily a Pinoy name. However, if you had watched the United States Olympic team in the last Olympics play against Russia, for the gold medal, the guy who served match point is a guy by the name of Gary Sato. Why do we list him down? Because his father was Japanese American from Hawaii. His mother was Chinese Filipino. Therefore, he's Pinoy. Now you wonder why Filipinos always have great answers, huh? Andover churches, postal club in Chicago, lodges, surrogate, those who did not have families belonged to lodges. Why did we have lodges? Because the white lodges would not accept Filipinos, including the Knights of Columbus. So we formed our own. Masonic, Di Masalam, Legionarios, Grand Oriente, we formed our own. Because again, the pension of the Filipino, the Pinoy, was to get together. Always to get together. We, tayo, tayo. Women too. They call each other brother and sister. Sis, tid, sometimes. Tid leon, meaning kapatid leon. Bro, brat. And we had our own music. Just fun. The woman behind that lichon was the only Pinay, along with one more up on top, in the whole state of Montana in 1935. But even then, in an isolated place called Montana, they still got together. And lichon, or Kahlua pig, is nothing compared to a Pinoy lichon. Gold mine. Uniforms and running elevators and being bellboys already had degrees from American colleges and universities. Remember in the 30s, this was depression time. And racism was very, very high. They were extras in movies. Next time you see these old rear rooms at 2 o'clock in the morning, and if Japanese or Indians or Mexicans, take a good look at the faces. They may be Pinoys in there. There's extras.
the 1st and 2nd Filipino Infantry Regiment. Now you have to understand, in World War II, the battalion, the regiment that Colonel Poncelot was the executive officer of, was composed of enlisted men who were either drafted or were enlisted in the United States. These did not come from the Philippines. These were Pinoys already in the United States. And that's what made this so unique. Two regiments. So the war effort, this was in Washington, D.C. Before they were shipped over, Colonel, you remember this, picture, Colonel? This was a great mass naturalization ceremonies that were afforded all of these Filipino-Americans in the 1st and 2nd Filipino Infantry Regiment. And that picture can go beyond where it's exit and to the first fold in the people that took advantage of that of the naturalization ceremonies. Because prior to July 2, 1946, Filipinos could not become citizens. Although they were nationals of the United States. Every one of the women who are wearing this Filipina peranas are Filipinized women. White, basically. But in their heart, they become like their husbands. War brides. Contrary to history, the Korean War brides and the Japanese War brides are not the first American war brides to come to this country. Remember in our history that America fought the Spanish-American War in 1898, and when you saw that picture back, way back in the front of that first woman in Seattle, she was among the first war brides when they came from the Philippines, as early as 1898. Asian war brides. Yeah. Anthony Quinn on your right, Duke, John Wayne on the left, and some of these were people who were extras in their films. These are now Los Angeles, second generation, and they're my age now. Conventions, conferences, always the idea of organizations trying to better themselves. Merchant seamen, another area of economic livelihood. This is New Orleans. And a couple of the newer faces that came to New Orleans by the 1930s. Now the second generation are beginning to marry. This is taken in the 1940s. Check out the hairdo on the men. Look at closely at their shoes if you can find it. They were thick, just like the Chicanos, like the suit suits and the pachucos. Strutting down the street, looking like a Minotaur. New immigrants began to arrive after World War II. It began to change our community slowly but surely on the West Coast. And then with the coming of the consulate corps, the consulate offices in New York, in New Orleans, in San Francisco, Los Angeles, Seattle, we now begin to have government officials who could then advocate for Filipinos, because our community organizations were still very, very immature in trying to deal with the establishment, with majority society, specifically to deal with white men. And we had our fairs and our queen contests and our coronations. But up in Alaska or in Seattle, many of the people were still going on boats to go up to the cannons. Now take a look at these dudes. You think they're going to go to a party? They're going to Alaska to work on the canneries. And yet look at the way they're dressed. Vicky Manalo Drakes, 1948. A Pinoy from San Francisco, mother is Irish, father is Pinoy, And before this picture was taken, nobody in San Francisco would claim her as a relative or even know her. She then proceeded to win the American title in diving, and in 1948 in London was the first American woman to win two gold medals in diving. She got on the front cover of Life magazine, and all of San Francisco began to claim her as their niece.
Vicky Manolo Graves. Oops.
They were protesting rents in the 40s. So he's pushing Pinoy too far, and he's going to be very, very polite to you. But push him a little too far, and watch out. You know, don't mess with him. Nurses from the Philippines, this is taken in the National Airport in Washington, D.C. We had new professionals ready to come. And more marriages. By this time, the first generation, the profession started to look like this. Believe it or not, these three men grew up with Alan Bregano. So you could about imagine what Alan looked like then, about 15 years ago. You saw them in 1988 here in Virginia Beach. Now take a look at this picture. This is the same picture as the drill team that we brought here in 1988. This is without now their fancy costumes. Everyone in that picture is a Pinoy. Every single one. So what does a Pinoy look like? It looks like you, and it looks like them. Those are down to the fourth and the fifth generation Pinoys. Some more college kids. She is the great grandmother of all these children. So you got to see now the bridge between the first, the second, the third, and the fourth. Those of you who will go on and write and record what our experience is, no matter what discipline you become, what I want you to do is to be cognizant of this bridge, this gap, this generation, so that you don't only talk about it from one perspective, you talk about it from all different perspectives. We've got to remember these folks who started it all for us, or the living history like Colonel Funsalan, that we don't only honor them and respect them, but more so that we ask them questions, because they are far, far better than any textbook that could ever be given. They are the ones that can tell you what it mean to live here back then. How much did it cost? What did they wear? What were they treated like? What did it mean to raise families? What does it mean to be a mother, a father, a grandfather, a grandmother? The highs in the graduation, and then the lows in their failures. This is what Pinoy history is all about. Lights, please.
This symposium is dedicated to Cherokee De La Rosa, a student at T.C. Williams High School, Alexandria, Virginia. She couldn't make it to our symposium on May 26, 1990 because of her medical condition. She has leukemia. Members of our organization and Pinoys in Virginia Beach wish her a happy and speedy recovery. Next year, our symposium will be in Washington, D.C. on the Saturday of Memorial Day weekend. Hope to see you there. In closing are some pictures of Pinoys in Virginia Beach, Virginia.
got to set me free.